Board of Education, District Administration, thank you for being here tonight. We're going to talk about innovative teaching and learning at West Orchard School. And before doing so, I want to introduce the team.
Hi, I'm Sarah Curry, the new art teacher at West Orchard.
I'm Erin Posner, fourth grade teacher at West Orchard.
Hello, Tom Williams, fifth grade teacher at West Orchard.
So tonight, we are going to focus on three areas and part of our goals and this year and in the coming years: innovative learning spaces, which for the last few years we've been working on making available to students, and finally have two nice spaces in the school so far. We also have a makerspace, and we're also going to talk about some design thinking projects that students have been doing. So this is the going back in time. You know, everything in education comes full circle. So 1971, West Orchard opened its doors, and this is the pamphlet that I found in an archive in my office. So West Orchard then and now. We'll just go take a little tour back in history. So these are this is a bifold, and this language in blue was lifted from the bifold. So as teachers, we are facilitators who foster student learning. We should provide freedom of space, time, and choice to encourage individual learning and growth. And learning is an active process. So if you look at our board strategic question and our goals as a district and school, all these words kind of really pop out, and this is back in 71. So students have individual plans. They have control of their own time and choices and ownership of their learning. The curriculum is personalized, and students work at their own ability level. Interest centers, which we now have makerspace, and a vertical sequence of skills. We have an articulated curriculum in each of the content areas. So again, many years ago, we're kind of doing the same things in a different way. Interdisciplinary projects, reading, writing, and math, make learning more engaging and relevant. So all this language in blue was popped out of the pamphlet. I just thought that was interesting.
I have a picture from
Yes. So that was kind of neat to see. So West Orchard 2017, the school was built back in 71 with the open school concept. So a lot of the walls at West Orchard are accordion style, so they can be opened up and you can adjoin classrooms. There are doors that go in between classrooms so teachers and students can collaborate. So in terms of where we are in our 21st century learning spaces and innovative learning spaces, West Orchard, the infrastructure and the footprint is perfect for what we're moving into in terms of creating spaces for students. So the concept of build it and they will come is something that I've been working on for the last few years. And because of declining enrollment, we've been able to create some common areas across the school. So traditional learning spaces are immobile, they're very structured and defined and limiting, whereas active learning spaces are flexible and mobile. You can move furniture around. You can configure groups in different ways and have different configurations of furniture and learning spaces. So this is a schematic of our second grade commons, which is a new learning space we created. And this is the same furniture reconfigured in two different ways. This is the actual space itself today. Our second graders in this picture are sharing their imaginary communities that they designed, and they needed large table spaces to do that. You'll notice that we have some soft seating, we have stools. Those tables have wheels and the chairs have wheels. So kids are wheeling themselves around a little too much, but we're working on that. They'll get that out of their system. But we have display monitors on two walls and a large one on the back wall. And we have two small learning nooks that you can see there. So students needed large table spaces to create these imaginary maps that they designed through a mapping unit. These are some third graders working on an advertisement video pitch that they were creating using laptops. This is a fourth grade group doing some research. And again, notice the flexibility of the space, the soft seating. The kids are relaxed. You know, back in 71, I could imagine they had the hard back wooden chairs with the inkwells and the desks, you know, the whole thing. So we've come a long way. Not quite Inkwells, but...
Yeah.
Thank you,
Jim. These are our first graders sharing their how-to pieces with students from other classes. So it's a very flexible space up in second grade commons. And it's basically two classrooms that we were able to take the wall down in between and create that space. So now we're down into fourth grade D commons, and this is made available through the Chappaqua School Foundation. This is some soft seating in our fourth grade commons. So again, you know, there's small tables, kids can relax, sit in groups. The flexible seating, those tables come apart and you can configure tables in different ways. We have mobile whiteboards, soft ottoman seating. So these are some fourth graders doing some work in that space. Notice that they're making themselves comfortable. The tables, again, are on wheels, so they can be reconfigured in the back on the left side of that photo. In the back there, there's a digital display that teachers and students can wirelessly share their work. Ideation on a lot of the whiteboard spaces that we have down there. Tables configured again in different ways, students spreading out. Very engaging space for students and teachers. Students are sharing their work, sharing their ideas. I'm going to turn it over to Sarah, who's been pivotal along with our librarian in creating a makerspace for students and providing them experiences in there.
So yes, I'm one of the facilitators in our makerspace. And just to give you the purpose and rationale, so to provide an active learning environment where students are encouraged to collaboratively problem solve concepts and ideas in order to make sense of the world around them. And teachers are encouraged to facilitate this learning and discovery through supported exploration, feedback, and questioning. So basically the idea behind Maker is the philosophy of problem solving through tinkering, play, and exploration. And while they're doing these things, tinkering, playing, and exploring, they're able to learn these dispositional skills listed up here. Collaboration, creativity, imagination, perseverance, courage, curiosity, adaptability, self-awareness, and passion, which is also known as the habitudes, which some of our students are very familiar with. So another big idea in the makerspace is this idea of, you know, interdisciplinary learning or cross-curriculum integration. And here, this is a lesson that I actually did with first graders as their introductory lesson into the makerspace. And this integrated math, art, and architecture. So the top middle picture is an artwork by Paul Klee. It's a famous artwork. And each table received this artwork, and I asked them to turn and talk. What do you notice? What do you recognize? What do you see? And through turning and talking, they come to the discovery of there are many shapes, there are many colors. It looks like he arranged the shapes to make buildings or even a city. So from this, we move on to working independently, and in a very open-ended way, I presented them and I said, here are pattern blocks. You're going to be creating your own building or part of a city. Think about how you can use this everyday math manipulative to create something different in a different way using the geometric shapes. And this partnered with the first grade curriculum where they're learning about the geometric shapes. So they worked alone, and then after they worked alone for a while, I had them turn and talk. What do you notice about your partner? Why don't you turn and talk? What were some things that were really successful that you really love about your building or your structure? What are some things that you struggled with? What are some things you would revise or change? So from this, we had students saying, well, maybe next time I wouldn't make it so tall because they were falling over onto the floor, or maybe I would make it a little more sturdy. So from this, I had them pair up in those partnerships or as a table and create their own city. So, one quick thing. So through this, the children were able to use divergent thinking and creativity, and it was so interesting to see how some students worked flat in a two-dimensional way, and other students were turning the blocks on their side or stacking and working three-dimensionally. So on the next slide, I have an example. This is a group that worked to create their own city, and there was really no instruction on what exactly to do. It was super open-ended. And just to see what this group of first graders created in October is amazing. So pay attention to the structures that they build and what they're explaining.
So tell me what you guys are making.
We're making the New York City parks and bridges and a town.
And a town. And Jack, what are you working on?
The amusement park.
Amusement park, Victorian gardens.
With gardens?
Victorian.
Oh, Victorian gardens. And tell me about yours, Justin.
I'm making a bridge.
A bridge. Ah, and tell me about yours, Rhea.
I'm making the cities and houses.
I see. Whoa.
Brooklyn.
You're adding Brooklyn?
No.
Yeah, it's Central Park and that in New York.
Oh, Central Park.
Yeah, Manhattan.
Gotcha.
So this was just interesting to see what they associated with the city. Naturally, that's our closest city. But having them use an everyday math manipulative to create, you know, their own city. We had children working, they created patterns and they created museums. And then another in the same group created another museum, but it was far enough because in a city, museums are not next to each other. They're a couple of blocks apart. So here we have a couple of examples of different maker experiences going on in the makerspace. So in the bottom left, there's a child putting a coffee filter into water with marker on it. And this is a very basic exploration of chromatography, which is seeing how colors can travel and be separated on a coffee filter. We have, in third grade, on the bottom middle, this is another example of cross-curriculum integration where this is from their science unit. They learn about the water cycle, and at the end, to kind of reinforce all the different topics and content that they've learned, they're creating their own water filtration systems. So that's very exciting. And fourth grade, the top pictures, we have Shark Tank, which Erin will be speaking about. And also on the top right, the students are working on creating an obstacle course within realistic parameters to accomplish various tasks that will actually be attainable in their PE class, and Tom will touch on that also. And first and second grade are working on literacy-based projects where they're actually recreating or creating a part of a book that they read. One of the things that I have created as part of the Makerspace team is this newsletter, and this is just a really fun and colorful way to inform our colleagues what is going on. So it's what is going on, what are other grade levels doing. I send it out monthly, and I've been sending also ideas for maker experiences that the teachers can take part in on their own to be excited about. And also on the bottom, there's a section to remind and encourage teachers to sign up for the Makerspace. So the feedback around the newsletter has been super positive, so I look forward to continuing to do that and sending that out. Thank you.
Thanks,
Sarah. Well, I think a nice transition before going into my project is just to say that a bonus that I didn't realize would happen with this work is getting to collaborate with Sarah and Ellen Moskowitz. Mrs. Elwood has been a great help, and I must tell you, having Mr. Skoog to cut sheet metal has been very, very helpful. But just for the students to also get to see their principal and teachers in different role in the makerspace, again, an added bonus. So I first want to tell you a little bit of how I got to Shark Tank and Makerspace Active Learning Projects, and that came from Habitudes. And during the 2015-16 school year, Allison Guerra led a faculty book group, and the second book that we selected was Classroom Habitudes. When Allison passed away in February of 2016, my class started to incorporate Habitudes, and it was a therapeutic way to keep her with us. And that launched my love for Habitudes even more, and my work has grown over the past 2 years. So that following school year, I started to take each of the Habitudes there, or the dispositions that Sarah discussed earlier, and pop out a different hands-on, interactive project to help them better understand the benefits and the importance of each, not just as fourth graders, but for life. And as the district moved toward makerspace and project-based learning, it just seemed such a natural fit. So this year was the second Shark Tank. I'm going to the next slide and I'll talk a bit. Oh, and with our district building goals, we really followed the design process, but naturally other phases kind of came out. But that was really the point from which we drew the process from. So Imagination Tank, or Shark Tank, is very much like the show, but it's an opportunity for students. So this was to explore imagination, but naturally all of the habitudes come out through this type of work. It was an opportunity for the students to come up with an idea, whether it's a business, whether it's changing a law, just some idea of something that they wish existed in the world, and to see it all the way through over a number of weeks and end up before a panel of three sharks. So the five-phase process, I'll take you through each one at a time. So brainstorming, I asked them to explore where will my imagination lead me? What am I passionate about? I feel happiest when? The thing missing from this world. And it was just an opportunity for first students to work on their own and think. And then in my class, we have positive Posner partners, which is a partnership where each person has partners have made a commitment to work well and to see the best in one another, so they could choose to also then brainstorm and work with their partner. And Sarah actually got to come and help in this process with me, so she saw it through all the different phases, and we had great conversations. And it's actually, we need to talk more about reflecting on where their product started and what it ended up turning into. So the next process was planning feedback, and as Jim mentioned, the great innovative spaces that we have, when we were working out in the commons, we were able to arrange the furniture like we were business people in focus groups. And we would, I call it Shark Spotlight, and one student or partnership would present their product or their idea before having made it. And then the rest of the class gave them feedback on why, and they pushed their thinking and they challenged them. And our winners, actually, if you go back to where they were at this phase, their product was totally different. And that day when we were out there doing our focus group, completely changed their product, and that's when they made their change and they ended up winning. You'll get to see what their product was. So using the makerspace, just, you should also know that their faces were lit up every day. They were so eager and excited, couldn't wait. They planned at home, they planned at school, and it's fun. It's disguised as fun, but they're learning so much. The different materials that they got to experiment. We got great new tools like our beautiful cardboard cutter. We had very minimal injuries throughout the process. And again, Jim handled our sheet metal. But in this, I have building, creating, making there, but it was really, really rebuilding, recreating, remaking, because as they tried different things, there were so many failures. But those failures, again, we have that view now, failing is not failing, but only a way to discover how to make your work better. So the final presentation, most had a Google slideshow, but what really wowed me was that some, without even our knowing, had scratch demonstrations of how their product works. So they used coding, others did commercials, some built their own website. So they really, this was even different from last year, you know, depending on what the kids bring as well. You can provide all the materials, but the students themselves are incredible resources, so that it will be different, I know, every time we do it. So those are our three sharks in the middle. It consisted of two parents in the business world, and Annie Pekarski was, for the second year, one of our sharks. And it's just a very nice way to give them their first public speaking, because as we all are witnessing right now, in your lifetime, you will have opportunities where you need to be in front of a panel and show that you're worthy of their time. So it's a wonderful opportunity. Also, again, using the Sea Commons was their forum with the sharks, and they had the big screens that were there, so it was a very unique opportunity for them that I know that they're going to remember. Here is one of our products. This is the pencil fiddler that Zoe and Julia made. Since fidget spinners were banned in our school, they were trying to find a small way where they could fiddle, but yet not have their teachers frustrated.
This one's my favorite.
Would you like to talk about the dropper
this
stopper?
This is the dropper stopper. So Jenna and Clara, for your ice cream cone, when it starts to melt, you know, to stop the drops, they created something that catches the ice cream drops from the dropper stopper. And this is their business card. She actually put her email and phone number on there. So I didn't want them to get too many orders early on.
And this year we actually had two in costume. So Jenna was in costume, and we also had a reindeer because Daniel and Jake created a deer repellent flower called the Smart Flower. And so one of them dressed up as a deer. This is our winner this year. This was Ezra and Alex, and they created the Fit Bottle, which is a weighted water bottle so that every time you take a sip, you're actually getting stronger.
Oh.
But to talk about, I could talk about how it grew. Originally, their idea consisted of adding weights without your children knowing, so that you were helping them to build their muscles. And the in the focus group, the children said, the other students said they didn't like the idea of parents being sneaky. Why can't you have a product where they know what it's for and make it positive?
And the real world issue that they were dealing with was obesity. So one of the things that we spoke to them about is thinking about real world issues. What can you do to help that issue or solve that issue?
So these are some short reflections of their process.
What were the challenges that you faced during the Shark Tank process?
Probably the feedback, because when you presented to them, our classmates, they would give you feedback and you would have to kind of maybe remake that part of your product or add more to your presentation.
Henry, what was the most important phase of Shark Tank?
Well, I say there were two of them, brainstorming and building, because you have to brainstorm a really creative and good idea, and then you have to make that idea come to life.
I was really proud of their reflections on the experience, so here are some of them. Shark Tank helped me understand the power of imagination and that your imagination can change the world. I understand the power of getting a good idea and the ability to create something from scratch. We had to think of an idea, fix problems, and create it with a lot of trial and error along the way. In my opinion, feedback was the most important step because it made us push ourselves harder and think really deeply. We even had one group who had a really hard time coming up with an idea, and in their presentation, they actually thanked the group and said, if it wasn't for you guys, you know, we don't know where you would be. And we did not tell them to say that, so they were very mature. Also, another thing that we're just working on throughout, I know it's not a habitude, but naturally kindness is something in the Chappaqua District that we're bringing in. And we talked about just being happy for one another, so when there was going to be an actual winner, making sure that you were happy for that person. So I guess the last thing I could say about it was just that it left them wanting more, so I'm very excited to continue with these type of projects for the other Habitudes and throughout the year.
Thank you. This is our first year in physical education in my curriculum that I'm taking on, project-based learning. The goal of it was to give students a greater understanding of what they could do outside of the typical sports that we have in this country to keep fitness in their lives and to give them an avenue outside of the school district and outside of those regular sports of what they can do independently. So in designing this, having them design their own obstacle course, I'm hoping that they will be better at making decisions about their fitness and their activity and play time and to take on more responsibility for it themselves. Also within this system of creating and designing, going into the makerspace, and then that gives them hands-on training to create models of what they're looking to design and run through in an obstacle course. You know, the questions up there, to have students design, or the goal was have students design their own obstacle course with certain parts of fitness that we try to encourage. One was strength, flexibility, cardiovascular, and also one of the goals for the students was just to be creative and have a fun obstacle course, because that's what's going to keep them engaged and coming back. So eventually, someday they will present this, perhaps to another class, and that's in the works. I didn't bring the sign-up sheet tonight, but if any of you are willing, there it is. Just before we get to that, I'm sorry. Go ahead and play the film. This is our obstacle course that I presented the students with. Just a little bit of forward that this was after a gymnastics-based unit. So in that clip, you see the students, we took individual skills and then linked them together for just to give them an environment where they could link things together and move from one block to another. So they did the forward roll, then they did the balance beam, then they did the vault. Instead of breaking down the skills individually, add the links together and create a larger base for them. The ropes, the girls that were swinging on the ropes, what you don't see in that is that they have to look up at the ceiling and make sure that their rope is lined up with the beam on the ceiling, so they're going to swing straight. So there's physics involved in all of this. They had to get themselves up on that rope high enough to get over that red mat, which is our volcano, and then across the green mat, which is our swamp, and land safely. Then they had to have their partners swing them the next rope, so they had to work together with their partners to get them back home safe. On the sled pull, we talk about grit sometimes, building grit with our students and having them challenge and make it through a math problem or make it, encourage them to write for longer periods. When you're faced with pulling that sled across the floor and getting it there independently, suddenly that rope isn't quite so short. And then you have to physically move the sled back. They had to work together as a team to get it back. The timing and the physics involved with swinging on the rings, we had to discuss whether the students should swing and let go, when to let go of the ball. When your momentum is carrying you forward, at the peak of it, when you stop, or on the backswing. So depending on their velocity, when they were moving, and what they wanted that ball to do to get it to land in that ring, they had to think that all out before they dropped the ball. The other students that were on the scooters, towing themselves along, we had to set up an anchor system for that to work. The ropes had to be taut, and the students had to realize and help each other out partner-wise to keep those ropes taut so the other student could pull on the scooter without waving all over the place. We then gave the students the opportunities after viewing this to move into the maker space and create a model that was based on what we did in gym class. In the future, we'd like to, as the units go on, we'd like them to add more to their obstacle courses and challenges. And then here I asked Sarah to help me out and go into the maker space because her ability to come up with final product as an art teacher was something I did not have experience in. And so she helped me out with the materials, how the students would utilize the materials, so we collaborated on that. I gave the students the basic goals, but then Sarah was able to fine-tune it and have the students work with the various things. So you could speak about how they made the...
So Tama came to me with this awesome idea, and we were trying to figure out how can we get a PE situation into the makerspace. And we were, thinking, how can we do this on a smaller scale and almost have them create a model of what a great obstacle course would be? So Tom brought in a bunch of equipment into the makerspace, and we lined it in the front of the rooms, and we told the students that they had the opportunity to go and explore the materials. How does this equipment work? What can you do with it? Then we, through talking and collaborating, came up with a couple of different materials, and we created this tray. There was felt on the tray, pipe cleaners, pom-poms, wood blocks, a bunch of different things. And when we presented them the tray, I had said, if you wanted to create a hula hoop or you want to use a ball in your obstacle course, what are some of these smaller scale materials that you could use? And they said, oh, well, you could take a pipe cleaner and bend it to create a hula hoop. We actually had one of the really cool things that we saw was a kid created a trampoline with, he used a pipe cleaner to make a circle and then used yarn and started tying it, wrapping it around to make it into a trampoline. They were cutting the felt and making mats out of the felt. And it was just so interesting to see without much guidance and with the super open-ended prompt to see what they were able to do with these different materials.
Yes, they also kept safety in mind. Underneath all the ropes and rings and high things that they want people to jump off of, they did have a mat underneath it, so that was good on their part.
So this is
one of our students explaining, again, this was only in half an hour's worth of work that they had this opportunity to create, and some of our students collaborated on this to do the following.
You have to go zigzag through the cones. And then you have to swing the both legs, then you go through these and climb on the climbing wall.
Then you go. Where it's magnetic, so
your
stay
jump
on.
Goes right.
It's magnetic, so.
No, then you climb up there, you jump here, then you jump here.
can I do
Teletubbies? I forgot to mention to the students that there were no superpowers and or force shields involved in the ability to complete the course. But as you can see, when the magnetic wall keeps falling over, one of the boys put a block right behind it to help them out. That was an immediate fix. But the students, you know, again, when they're creating these things, we see this on television with the variety of shows. American Ninja Warrior is a common obstacle course show. There are other games on ESPN called CrossFit Games where, you know, there's sled pushing, there's Olympic lifting, other fitness venues besides just your typical sports that we think of in this country as four major sports. So I just want to give the students outlets and let them realize in elementary school that there are outlets for this, not just Newcastle Rec Department, but other gymnasiums where these things can occur and are occurring. And I've seen a student with a Spartan Race shirt on, so I know his parents are involved in it. And so there's other outlets for these students to be physically fit and ways to construct it, and who knows what that will lead to for some of these students in the construction process beyond the fitness process in shaping their thinking. So the goal again is to have another party or another group of students run through the course, and then they'll provide these students with feedback as to likes, dislikes, how to improve, and move forward. So.
And that is the end of our presentation.
Comments or questions from the board?
You can come by and try out the course if you want.
And I don't know when you got into sheet metal cutting.
Right. I had to help him with the build his robot.
There you go. Well, see a need, fill a need. We talk a lot about resilience. And obviously, in a fun and engaging activity like this, where there's no grades involved or anything like that, if something falls and you get it back up and you do it again, do you find that skill transferring to the more frustrating tasks of doing math or reading a book that's challenging you to look up words or writing for longer periods of time? Do you find them digging deep to use those skills that they're getting out of this in other more traditional learning experiences?
I definitely do, and okay. I think there's more to go this year, but in discussing my own APPR work with Mr. Skoog this year and talking about the particular bunch of students that I have, I've felt that they've needed growth in this area. And the example I can refer to is I always incorporate Jeopardy as an end of the unit game. Mm-hmm. And the first time I had Jeopardy this year, it started out amazing. It was competitive. It was exciting. And then when someone was about to win, you could just see the faces where they were about to break down. And, you know, we discussed how in life there are going to be times where everyone's not going to win. Sometimes someone else is going to get the question right. You might make a mistake. And before launching Shark Tank, I sat them down and I reminded them of this experience that we had. And I said, let me explain to you what's gonna happen if we do this. And if we all come with this same mindset, it's not gonna be a positive experience for us all. So we kind of made this pledge together, and talking about the habitudes and what they are and why they are, it was great. If you know, in the room there wasn't a single soul who was disappointed. There wasn't anyone who said, oh, if I had done this better, then I could have been the one. So they really were very flexible, and I am finding that it is working in the classroom, but again, long way to go. Yes, math is a different story, but now I have also a reference point. So I can say, you know, when in Shark Tank you experienced this, this is like this, but this is math. So give yourself time. Try to look at it from another way. How can we problem solve? So I think there are tremendous benefits that can be correlated back into the academics.
And how much time out of your day or out of your week are you devoting to this? And it's a terrible question. What are you giving up? Or do you feel like you're not giving anything
up? It's an interesting discussion with my colleagues of why they either are or are choosing not to do some of the work that I'm doing. And I think the benefit is I'm still doing the same writing, the reading, the math, the science, and the social studies. I think one of the things that is motivating them is they're so excited to do this work because they know we've reserved that hour or that hour and a half for the Shark Tank work. So I'm like, hey guys, this afternoon we're meeting Mrs. Curry in Makerspace. So we're doing three subjects right now. And I think it kind of has sucked up some of that downtime, which can lead you off task.
So it's actually been a time benefit.
So is this going to go throughout the entire year then?
I have one project for each of the seven habitudes. Not all of them are as intensive, but this year I have Mrs. Curry. Last year I was doing them on my own with support of administrators, but we've already talked about, I shared what my adaptability project is, and she has some great insight, and now it almost seems like my adaptability project will be a warm-up, what I did last year, to this new project. So I think I'm actually going to purposely try to make them more involved with the makerspace just because of the benefits that I'm seeing, without, of course, trying to make sure I hit everything needed.
So it's great that it's cross-curricular, but not just one, it's academic, arts, and athletics all wrapped into
one. Totally, and also the kids are they're so excited to tell me about the progress that they had. I mean, I'll be out there at bus studio, and I had Ezra come up to me, and he goes, "You're never going to believe the progress that I made. You weren't there today, and I can't wait to show you." And it's just like, I'm so excited to see children so engaged, and that the active learning is taking place in that environment.
As Tom spoke, you could hear there's science involved in some of the obstacle course work, and students are learning content through these projects. But I think more important than that, they're actually learning process skills and learning dispositions like resiliency, like how to fail well and iterate and try again. I mean, in one of the videos, the kid said, "Well, you know, I got feedback from my peers, so I had to improve and revise my thinking and my project." So those dispositions and those learning processes are very valuable.
One last question, that the language the kids are using when giving feedback to peers, we've spent many, many years talking about feedback and what actionable and appropriate feedback and how to chime in with each other and do it appropriately. We've watched many videos and many presentations. Are you finding that is translating into appropriate ways of giving feedback or criticism or critique, and that they're using good language and they're imparting all the stuff that we've been trying to teach them?
I certainly think it's worth it working. Yeah. The fact that you even brought it up themselves, I think, means they're more comfortable with it. They understand it's a natural part of the process. This has also worked really well to help our writer's workshop work, because you're getting feedback from your peers when you're sharing your writing. Also, when we did the Shark Tank Spotlight, in addition to speaking to their peers, they had to do written feedback so they could actually then give that form to that group so they could take it home, almost looking at it like data, like research for them to cull through. And I think that I'm called the positive Posners, so I don't allow any negativity. You can give feedback, and yes, it essentially is saying they think there's something negative, but the way they know within my walls, you have to say it within a certain way. And they know that if everything's perfect, why are we all there? We all have a lot to learn. But it does take a maturity, and yeah, they do have to practice it and to understand that it's a natural process.
Do you think including these helps them focus more with the more traditional learning? Like, are they able to pivot off these projects when they're deeply involved and then, like, budget their time better because they're excited to do it? Or, you know, does it help them focus on the different aspects of their day in a different way? Have you noticed any change in that aspect?
So I do think so, because, mm-hmm. Yeah, as I've said, they were able to kind of make their time more concise and
right.
more powerful.
More so efficient in their
but
planning.
But to the flip side, being, you know, fully disclosing, when I was doing our reader's workshop lesson on the unit, Reading Our Weather, Reading Our World, I had told Jim this, but they're researching a particular weather group, and the first thing my students said was, "Can I make a model of this?"
Right.
When they were just supposed to be doing pen and paper research. So it is catchy. They do,
right.
they create
they
the
stay
ability
active.
For the different
yeah.
modalities.
Jeffrey? I just want to say that one of the important factors that I see in this work is student engagement. Mm-hmm. And I see that increasing exponentially. And I think that when you engage students more, they'll do better overall. They'll enjoy coming to school. And you'll find, you know that correlates to higher student achievement. That's really the goal. I'm just wondering if you found that you're doing less of the traditional assessments in doing this work, and is this work changing your practice as a teacher in the formal aspects of your work in terms of grading? Because we talk about all of these wonderful, you call them habitudes, and these are habits that will serve these kids you know, better than a whole lot of other things when they go out into the world, to learn to collaborate and to work with others and to communicate with each other. So in doing more of this work, are you finding that you're using different types of assessments? You know, the typical assessment that I think of is, you know, your multiple choice test, which is, you know, terrible.
I don't know if this is going to answer your question, but in fourth grade, I made a volcano, and I still remember the volcano.
Exactly.
Making it erupt, having, you know, learning about geology. And so I think these kids are going to remember this experience. They're going to remember the foundational skills as well, but as they get older, they're going to always go back to some of these active experiences.
Right. I'm always interested in how we take these sort of abstract concepts and these active learning experiences and change the way we assess students, because we are working with very arcane models of assessment. You know, the most arcane being the state assessments. Then we have our own local assessments. And so we've moved traditional teaching to this form of active-based teaching. How are we going to incorporate this now into how we assess our students? I think that's the next challenge, because, you know, we rub up against the real world at that point. You know, so what do you tell the college admissions officers about how you grade students? You know, that's where, you know, you start to experience conflict, is where you have to face the outside world. You know, we can look inwardly and say, this is wonderful, the kids are learning, they're great. How do we show that in a way that the community understands, that people outside of the community understand, such as colleges, people looking at our schools? I think it's a question for the entire educational system. Mm-hmm. You know, how we truly assess kids, what assessments are really truly valuable. Kids are not going to go out into the world to take multiple choice tests. They're going to go out and work with people and solve problems in exactly the same way they're doing in the classroom. So, you know, in our district, we're always looking for ways to progress and move forward. We've been doing this work for a lot longer than a lot of districts. We really started this work maybe 10 years ago with a lot of professional development, a lot of work in the background. And now we see a lot of other schools talking about this sort of work and, you know, changing up their spaces. But I think that, you know, we're always trying to move forward in this district. And so I think we have to figure out a way to take this work and do something even more progressive with it. You know, because as a board, we're here to set a vision for the district. So we have to look at where we are now, which you're describing really well, and where we want to go. So where do we go from here? Because we always have to look at improvements. And so I see the assessment piece as a real challenge moving forward. Because we have people saying, well, this is nice, but prove to us that, you know, it's working. What can you show us? And a lot of this is abstract. And so I think that's a challenge.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think looking at performance-based assessment is really what you're talking about. And we have that in our reading, writing, and math. We have our local assessments that we created that are much more relevant, formative, and meaningful than any commercially publicized assessment. At least that's my bias.
No, wait, Jim, correct me if I'm wrong. Those are assessments for APPR.
Some of them.
Is that what you're talking about?
Some of the local assessments.
Right.
You know, the local assessments that we've created for APPR are all performance assessments. So they have, sometimes the performance is just a piece of writing. But when you think about the design process, so, you know, starting off with the brainstorming, planning, iterations, getting feedback, revising, making it better, even that piece of writing is a performance. But I think what we're seeing here tonight really has potential for assessing not just some of the content skills, and we could think about a more formal process for that, but the dispositional skills. So some of those habitudes and habits of mind that are really important as well. And what I see in this work that's so exciting and I think really significant is metacognition. Students are thinking about their thinking, they're thinking about their learning, they're thinking about how they can improve upon what they do, and all of that's really important. So going back to what you said, we're kind of assessing what we value, and I think meshing the two systems where we'll always have some formal assessments that are much more content specific perhaps, but these have potential for interdisciplinary performance assessments that measure much more.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I have to assume that.
I'm sorry, Jane. Go ahead.
No, I have to assume also it's a boon to the social and emotional well-being of the children. So I'm curious if you're seeing them much happier with each other in terms of social interactions, just because putting them in groups like this, where they're, I'm sure it's getting changed up a lot. Do you find that the emotional growth of the children is affected? Because it seems like it would be in a positive way.
That's always kind of been a priority in my classroom before even having Habitudes. I've always thought that if they feel cared for, supported, they're going to learn better. And I think they have this bond of this project that we've done that not everyone in fourth grade has been involved in. And yeah, I think it raises them. They felt like little executives, you know. So they
talk about real life.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. So I do think so, but I also do think that that's why I need to carry the work throughout the year. So it's not an isolated experience. Oh, remember we did Shark Tank.
Right.
It has to be a constant that is brought up again and again. And we live it together. We bond together about it. And sure, we're not, you know, the Brady Bunch in there. But they need to learn how to work with someone that you don't necessarily have the same set of skills or the same desires and the same interests. And that's why I've created the Positive Posner Partnerships, because it's self-selected based on certain things that you know you're going to have to do together. Mm-hmm. And so it's that level of commitment. And then throughout the year, I ask them, do they want to keep partners or change? Mm-hmm. And it always really means a lot when there are two partners who have been able to, through the whole course of the year, remain partners and still continue to collaborate positively.
Great.
So you can ask me at the end of the year how many
stay together.
Right.
I just want to. Sorry.
Sorry. You know, we've all as parents had our kids come home doing homework and in exasperation say, "When am I ever going to use this?" Right. And there's not always a good answer for that because I don't use a lot of the things that content that I learned in school, but these are skills that you can absolutely unequivocally say you are going to need and use these skills every day in your real life, and I think that's really
great.
I just wanted to add two things. One thing that I wanted to add, just being a specialist teacher and seeing this fourth grade class come through my classroom after doing a project like this, seeing how they are kinder to each other and they do care for each other, and if there's someone maybe that's not making the best decision, having another peer saying, you know, maybe you could do this, or remember what, you know, it is coming through, and I'm noticing that, and I see the whole school. And back to what you just said also, these dispositional skills, we were just talking about this morning, these are skills that make you a better person for life, a better learner, a better worker, a better teacher, a better person, better whatever you're doing. You're going to have to work with people, whether it's collaborating on a presentation, corporate level, teaching, whatever it is. These are critical dispositional skills that everyone needs to operate in a positive way.
So I just wanted to thank West Orchard for such an excellent presentation and such a diverse way to show us how the kids are using the design process across different mediums in the school. But I also wanted to pull out, before any final thoughts or closure, that what a tribute, Aaron, to your colleague. And I didn't miss that, and I'm sure many people in this audience didn't miss that either. And what better way to honor someone that you care deeply about than through working with our children here in this district? So I wanted to thank you, and I know some of your colleagues have also shared with me the commitment to Habitudes, not only because they believe in that methodology, but because of the passion that your colleagues showed towards leading that effort in this district. So I wanted to acknowledge that for this community.
Thank you.